Thank you, Rich, and welcome. For us, it's always a pleasure to share and try and get some, where we can provide some input. Hopefully, y'all will enjoy it as well. We do have one rule for the session, and that is, it's a success if we have fun. So we invite y'all to enjoy it as well. We can't control that part. We're gonna do our best. And for the folks coming in, it's kind of like church. You come in late, there's always spaces up front. So the strategy and the idea today is how do you take and maximize the value of a program from establishing expectations and then running all the way through an operations aspect. From an executive viewpoint, you will notice potentially that because Butchko being a common last name, we are related. My father with his background, is executive. A little bit myself, do have an engineering background have done everything from protecting nuclear weapons on to trash trucks and around the globe. And so I'll let my father give a brief introduction as well.
I spent 31 years in the Air Force, primarily in flight test and system development. I was also the president, CEO of the company that runs Kennedy Space Center in Cape Canaveral. And among other things, we had responsibility for armed security and law enforcement. And I spent the last 7 years prior to retiring for the third time at the nuclear test site. In fact, my head of security there is present today, and I'm going to use him as a benchmark. When his lips stop moving, then it's time to change charts.
So, these slides, these were uploaded, so they should be available along with a couple other, at least one other item of materials on the website. I'm not sure if they're up there as yet. But they are available. So I'll let you read through. But really the idea is, if you're pulling together a program and you talk about a system for that program, the system is the whole continuity of technology, personnel, and process. So tying those together in a means that brings value to your mission as an organization. And that mission can be, if in retail or healthcare, I ran security engineering for ExxonMobil. So we've been in around the globe in a lot of places. You don't want to take your family and friends for vacation, and that's where you turn nasty brown stuff into money. So lots of different ways to do it. How do you make sure that it's being effective and that it is repeatable performance that you can move forward? So The whole idea, which if you've worked around and you go to a lot of the sessions, is that security is a continuum. It is a process. There's really no start and stop point. And so when you're looking at analyzing risk is really the establishment of what are the problems and what are the expectations. So we have one company that we work with. They're losing $1.5 billion a year. Well, they've analyzed the risk. They understand what that is. The expectations, when they move from looking at the aspects of risk, threat, assets, protection measures, and moving into the master plan, is in that process is the negotiation with the business entity and with the senior management of what is the acceptable level of risk. This one organization losing $1.5 billion a year, their acceptable level of risk, their target, if they can prevent it, is to improve it to where they're only losing 30% of that. If they can reduce that loss in 30% in a year, they're excited. So if they reduce all $1.5 billion, they shut down their $10 billion in revenue as well. So it's that balance which moves into the operations, and that's the whole training, implementation, ongoing performance, and giving that in both a financial payback and an operations payback, and realizing that the world is always changing. The threats don't stay static. The assets will change. You bring in new people, your business changes, the cost of your commodity changes. All of those factors come into play. And the more you can take a dynamic view of that risk and look at risk on, one of the challenges of a lot of assessments are, we just did a project, came in after an assessment was performed. The assessment was performed in December of last year. We did the design in July and August. They never got the final report. They're still working on the final report of the risk assessment. So we're making decisions based on last year's risk. One of the goals that we certainly have, and we've worked very hard with, is to move that to where you need to make decisions based on today's risk, based on germane information as to what's going on. And that is a challenge. There are avenues to get there, and we'll try and talk through some of those as well. The theme, even though we're in the security business here, there's probably very few companies that their purpose is just security. And even in the context, if you are a security provider, as Richard McCow is on with Allied Barton, is their service is to provide someone else's company that's probably not a pure security company. So it is, the operations should provide value all the way across that organization and support the overall mission function, not just security for the sake of security. And leadership is key. That's a lot of the things that my father will be discussing as well, is, and that's leadership all the way from every level up and down the organization. How can you build that leadership context and have an organization that supports it? Making sure you've got current information so you can make the right decisions at the right time, and integrating the organization. Not just integration from what you'll see on the show floor with technology and integrating video with access control or alarms. Although that is certainly an important aspect, that's just one of the tools that comes into play. So this is our roadmap of success. We're going to step through the elements from how do you set the best foundation. And if you want to screw up a project, put the wrong foundation in place and come up with the wrong problems to solve. Misidentify your assets or your flexibility. When you've got these refined well, then you can move through and actually operationally execute. But that's the same way with the design program, with a training program, or a hiring program. You bring in the wrong folks, then you're out of luck. So this is the Security 101 base piece. What's risk? Well, what is the probability of an event? What's the impact of that event if it were to occur? What are your vulnerabilities that are there? So if you've got a truck and the truck has got the keys in it and it's running, then you are vulnerable and the door's unlocked, you're vulnerable to it being stolen. If it's sitting inside a concrete bunker and the bunker's locked, the vulnerability's gone. You have to have all three of those elements in place, and before you get the actual risk, and realizing that risk can manifest itself in different ways and interpret it in different ways. So what's more important to you, death or $200? I guess it depends on which side of the coin you're living. And why the Newcastle Tramway Authority in the UK would use a dollar sign, I find rather entertaining as well. But I figure at least the Canadians in the room who at least have some tie to the Queen can probably give us some better answer on that than we can. So when you tie into mission, how many of y'all have worked for a public organization, publicly traded organization? How many of y'all have seen the corporate 10-K? I would challenge y'all to find it 10K is a filing requirement for public and traded companies in the United States from the Securities and Exchange Commission. This is what the board of directors and the C-suite views as the threats and the risks to your company. If you can understand how the executive team views risk and what they're trying to avoid, now you can start looking at and making that comparison that says, are the elements of my security program, are they contributing to address what's important to my executives? And if they are, you're probably going to get a lot better response when you're coming to them looking for resources, looking for someone to champion your activities and support the decisions that you're making. If you're moving in one direction and the corporation is moving in another, that should raise a red flag. So here are some examples. And I think the challenge, and even to the point of when we were looking, we were addressing a petrochemical facility. And I went to the guard force supervisor and asked what business that person was in. And her instant response is, well, I'm in the guard business. And I challenged, and her job was to try and prioritize upgrading all their security procedures and managing getting everything in and out of that in and out of that refinery. I challenged her and said, no, you're in the oil and gas business. You're turning nasty brown stuff into money. So when you look at your priorities and when you're prioritizing your actions, think in terms of how does that get the right people and the right resources into this refinery that need to come in, keep the wrong folks out? And on the other side, how do I let just the right things go out of that refinery and do it in an efficient manner so the important stuff gets in quickly? The folks that I've got questions about, I want to pull off and delay those. Keep that context in mind. It can even be done at whatever level in the organization. And if you're a leader in the organization, the 10K provides that same level of benchmark. So if you look up, these are examples that I just took. I took and pulled 10 Form 10Ks off the internet within the last year, reviewed some of these. Depending on where these companies were sitting, Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. If you're operating internationally and you're a U.S. company, that one will get you and your executives thrown in jail. I don't know that certainly you would have been very excited if someone in your organization screwed up and you got thrown in jail because of a bribe, a corruption activity. He's got a good sense of humor, but it has its limits. So a lot of things that are currently up are related to mergers. If you're in oil and gas, it's either mergers or selling. What are those issues? Regulatory issues, and a lot of cyber issues that are in play. How can you align with, when you know what these threats are, these risks that are perceived, especially if in your organization, cyber attacks are really key? How can you contribute to support the IT organization in their efforts? Because a good way to get in, we had one client that we came in to support, and their question was, how come we lost all of this primary information? Well, because someone drove through the data center wall and they just started taking racks of equipment out. And then they used that information to come back in and hijack the network. So different ways, social engineering, how can you support those activities? Has anybody used the 10K? I know not. We hadn't a bunch there. It's a segment that's in there. It's actually pretty easy to find on the risks. It is a requirement that they list those in that document set. So we have, this is actually a manifestation of a perspective that we take within our company. The model applies that if you're really looking at information management is how you manage risk. That information from the 10K, that is an example of information you can use and apply that back in your discussions with the executive team. And the more you understand that risk, the more you can then apply the right answers. So what are some of the elements that are key to a program? Certainly risk analysis. And risk analysis has a long history. It actually goes back to the nuclear weapons program in the United States for formalized systems. It happens to be where I learned how to manage, how to deal with it. But the same idea of a context. You've got to gather your information, interviews, operationally understanding, reviewing documentation, understanding the elements of your business operation. How can you do predictive analytics? Can it be a soft issue? Can you use big data analytics? That's a mode that we've done. We actually got a write-up in the current version of Security Magazine talking about some ways you can use predictive analytics to actually get a look at where are the threats going? How is that adapting? How is your business market changing? Factor that into your risk. So now you're looking at dynamic risk that gets updated, not just every once every 1 to 3 years or 5 years. Project management. Project management of the process of defining the risk and the process of managing your solutions. It's leadership and understanding expectations, and it's leadership and expectations. That allows for the process to take this through, and then if you have a system that is working well, you've got performance metrics where you've got alerts that are flagging off, so you're looking and managing in a means of exception reporting. The idea of having reports that keep putting out and set up on the wall that don't get read but once a year or once every 3 years, how can I get that information when I need it all the time? That is what we find in working with our clients, is the goal of a metric is identifying not only is it germane, but is it timely? And if you don't have both, then why bother? You're rather off with just a few metrics than a whole bunch that don't apply. So as we're living with the program management, the whole process, we're going to focus on the two lighter elements here. But it all needs to be complementary. Corporate mission, your 10K, your SEC filings. What is it that you hear when the CEO, the COO is talking to others, talking to your team? What's published? We'll go into organizational resilience. Business continuity planning is one element. The idea is, how does this business fail? And how do you help it continue to operate when you have a problem? We live in Houston. It's been a light hurricane year. When a hurricane comes through, we've had flooding, we've had other issues. When you get 30 inches of rain in 24 hours, how do you keep your business running when half of it's underwater? We learned several years ago, you don't put the emergency generators in the basement. Like folks in New York found that out as well when they found out subways don't work too well when they're underwater. So if you could plan for understanding that aspect and look at all of your resources as a pool that have to work together as an integrated set, that's where your value comes into play. And the master plan, in the simplest mode, is how many of y'all feel like your security program is going in kind of a helter-skelter manner? Even a professional, the most professional systems that I've been in that were most structured all had aspects that were out of alignment. If the master plan is aligned with something that the CEO supports, you're going to have more support on trying to keep that and give yourself means to keep those things moving in the right direction. Even if it's not instantly as exactly where you want to be. But keep moving one step at a time and get to where you're actually looking at, you are viewed, and the more you can get, and I think the best performance metric just from a subjective piece within the security organization is, the more the business entities are asking you for help, the more you are contributing into this area. The more you're having to push to get to them, to see your vision, and to move it forward, you're still operating in this mode down here. So that's kind of a real quick thumbnail check as how far are you along this path. So now the question, the challenge is when they start asking for more help, are you staffed up to be able to do that? Do you have the resources? But I don't know your perspective is how do you get those extra resources? If there's a demand somewhere, it's going to, there'll be an effort to fill it. So what does that master plan look like? It is really, that's your roadmap. It's your negotiated roadmap with senior management. They need to, the COO ideally will buy into your master plan. If it never goes past the head of security, then all you're doing is you're playing in your own sandbox. You're not playing in the corporate sandbox. With our clients, we work with them, and the objective is to get buy-in, at least at the executive summary level, that master plan is approved and accepted by senior management. And that makes a huge difference. And we socialize that across the general counsel, across the operationals elements. If it needs, depends on the type of organization, if it moves into, if marketing's a big key, or if HR, all of those elements come into play so that you've got allies to support that plan. And they see where you're contributing to them. And the best piece is if you're contributing to them, you can find out how they can contribute to your goals and your success. This document is actually sitting on the portal. Some guidance that we've put together. What are the kinds of questions that you need to be able to answer for the CEO? What are your priorities and expectations? And some of those, what happens, are these basic? How are you contributing? What happens when the wheels fall off of the organization? How are you going to get that vehicle moving again? And how are you working within, how are you managing your budget and protecting it? So all of those elements come into play as that framework. And the security management system. The system is really, and all of this can be separated in a separate format, or it can be tied in. But the idea is that the master plan provides you that strategic guidance. The management system is your means of managing policy and procedure, so that you move down into what are the tools and practices. What's my response force? Have I bought technology? What's my training program? What's my professional development program set up? So that if I have someone needs to leave, or they do leave the organization because they've been promoted, they've changed companies, they've had a change in their life that moves them over, what do we have here? And it's all in a context that one layer keeps working in benefit and in conjunction with the other. So they are integrated. Common systems that are set up. One we set up for one of the oil companies was set so that it matched their safety system. They had a formalized safety system. Rather than creating the wheel, we just blended that in with the security system. So where they had safety investigation, now we had security investigation. And at this point, hand some more over on really organizing to take this from one step all the way through the process.
Okay, I suspect that we have various levels of security represented in this room. And what I have found over the years is that if senior management is excluded somehow by going through too many layers, then you do not have the system performance that you need to assure security of whatever it is you're doing. I've dealt with conventional weapons, high risk in terms of safety, high risk in terms of security. I've dealt with protecting the space shuttle. I've dealt with protecting nuclear things. Turn the lights off, I glow in the dark, just like Devin over there. But you must figure out a way, I believe, And it has to also come from top down, because that's where I get into the advice to companies, is the involvement at the higher levels to help the guys that are in the trenches do their job. I never had security more than one level removed from me from the time I got into senior management until I finally retired for the third time. And but generally, I had the security individual, whether I was the commander, the CEO, or the COO, security reported directly to me. I made sure I knew what the heck was going on. I was able to tell that individual that was working for me what needed to be done. What we're going to talk about here today is where you fit. If you're buried, you're not going to be very effective. Are you independent or not? Let's say you work for, that you're the security guy and you work for corporate counsel. Difficult position to be in. As you may or may not know, you know, the legal field is one of the few elements that makes no positive contribution to the society. They kind of run, they run interference. And you're being interfered with. And then, but where does it report in a company structure? At the nuclear test site, I'm going to get into that for operational difficulties, but I was COO, the head of security reported directly to me. At Kennedy Space Center, I elected to have security, law enforcement, and emergency response all in the same organization. Again, reported directly to me. The commander, when I was commander at the Weapons Center in Florida, I had two wing commanders in the structure. So I had two full colonels reporting to me. One was the test wing, and the other one was a base support wing. All right. And in that wing was security. Okay, the security guy reported to the base wing commander, and he reported directly to me. That was probably the farthest away that I ever had in an organization was security, because I firmly believe that it was my responsibility for security. It wasn't that gentleman right over there at the nuke site responsible for security. It was my responsibility. I had to do everything I needed to do to make sure he could be successful. Because let's face it, if you're a more senior position, if your people are successful, you are too. And you give them credit for it. So that's a very important element as to how things will work. Ben, next chart. Okay. The best place to be is where you are reporting it to a more senior level, so you have more influence and you get the support of that individual. Fully integrated organization. I don't know how often you have found those, but when I took over down at Kennedy Space Center, I met the senior staff, about 10 of them, 10 very sharp individuals. It was not a team made up of 10 sharp directors. They really didn't know the impact of their actions on the other directors. For example, I always use the term the roads and commodes guys, you know, the infrastructure guys. If they did things one way, it was a direct charge. If they did things another way, it was an indirect charge. And guess what? Overhead went up. But the director there didn't know how what he was doing impacted the indirect cost. He was worried about getting the job done. So what did I do? We started out by working together. Every senior individual was involved in the development of the budget, direct and indirect. They toured each other's elements, so they knew exactly what was happening. In that, we got this kind of the Venn diagram. Everything was organized and understood. The security organization, yes, it's in there, could be independent or it could be part of another function, but direct line up to me. So that's what the fully integrated organization is. If you're at the lower end of the scale, it's difficult to get there. What you can do is lead by example. If you're the security guy, you go around and you start talking to every part of the organization that can either support or can be in your way. And then you try to lead that effort and get it going on up. Eventually, you'll get there, but if you don't get there, you're going to be suboptimum. Next chart.
And when you're doing that, It's one thing when you go out and you're talking and you're going in and meeting with all these other organizations. The key is, remember, people hate to be sold something, but they love to buy. Take that same perspective when you're talking with folks and you're socializing around the organization. Go to them and find out, what are their needs? Where are they finding issues and challenges? And where is your organization being a problem for them? Come in just to help them from that perspective, and then filter in through those discussions the services that you can offer. But lead with them, because who's the most important person in the room when you're talking with somebody else? If it's your perspective, it's you. If it's their perspective, it darn sure ain't you. It's them. So the best way is talk to them about what's important to them, and then filter in and back it up so that you can take that process of leading by example and move in and get that appreciation, because you're going to have some folks in the leadership that are going to really see that vision and take that to task, and others that are going to miss it. But what they'll see is they'll see a better improvement within their organization, and whether you get the direct recognition of that or not, or you get to move along with the wave that you've helped create, then everybody comes out to win.
Next chart. Now, what, in a nutshell, what we're doing here, this establishes what are the risks and how they relate to where the corporation wants to go. When the corporation figures out where they want to go, they may be willing to accept risk at level 2, but they won't accept because they can't accept the higher risk. So what then happens, that goes into the security master plan. Those are the security requirements. That document should, as Ben said, should be signed by at least the COO level. Not the corporate risk manager, but this a higher level. Now then, given that you have a requirement that is defined by your user, how are you going to do it? Who's going to do it? Not when, how, who, and what's it going to cost? When you figure that out, when are you going to do it? Specific, who is going to do it? What's it going to cost? How long is it going to take? And finally, you come out with the security system developed. You test it. Don't be like what I've always had the biased view on. You know, Bill Gates' help desk number is 1-800-GET-LOST. You know, when they look at beta testing, who do the IT experts beta test with a lot of the time? Other people who really understand IT. But what about Bubba? He turns it on, what the heck, over? I have no idea what the hell to do with this. Excuse my French. What to do with this system? It's supposed to be user-friendly. I see it as user-hostile. But the IT guys loved it. Okay, so when you test it, I was in flight tests for a lot of times. I was a development test pilot. In other words, did the system meet the design specifications? Not did it do the operational job. It was supposed to be designed to do the operational job. But then the operators got in. They did their testing. They developed the tactics given the system that we were giving them. So you have to look at it in the same way. Not the developers look at it to make sure it complies. The operators look at it to make sure it's useful, because it might not be. You may have made it so cumbersome that you really can't get the job done. You have to take into account human factors. I'll give an example. We had in one of the nuclear areas, it was a two-person policy. One person couldn't go in. When they were going to access the area, they had to make a phone call to the guys with guns to make sure that they were cleared in. When it came back out, they had to make a phone call that said, okay, I've secured it, I've locked it up. Well, we were having incidents where people didn't call. Why? The dadgum phone was about 100 yards away, and they could get distracted in between. So they forgot to make the call. Nothing was insecure, but it looked like it was insecure. So human factors is very important in how things are designed so that they'll be used better, even when somebody is tired. Can they operate the system as well at the end of shift as they can at the beginning of shift? Make it part of it.
And then, can your maintenance guys
fix it?
Can they fix it? Can they keep it running? And remember, this is maintenance when, at the executive level, when he's talking system, he's talking the operational context of people, process, and technology. So it's not just the folks with the wrench fixing it. Can your corporate trainers, can your leaders maintain when you have a manpower function that gets degraded? How can you bring that back up? Is there enough rest time that's involved? Is there enough time to maintain the system if there's a failure in there? So it is that whole, you know, and I'm an engineer twice over, so I'm geek squared. So when you get the geeks like me in the room, we can make sure that the stuff will do the electronically what it's supposed to do. But it's like when you buy a truck and you order it just the way you want it and it gets delivered. Well, that's great. The guys like me come in and make sure you can crank the engine, you can move it around the parking lot. But you have to have somebody else that can come in operationally and say, can I drive that across town with a 10,000 pound load, load it, unload it, and move it off? And then, is there any way for folks to change the oil? All that has to be tied in at that system. And when I'm too tired, especially if it's regulated trucking, is there a backup driver that can keep that truck moving? So that's that context of system that really depends on your point of reference.
Now, when you can get the system development and pat yourself on the back and you can put it into operation, but if you do not keep a continuous loop going of measuring the system performance and feeding it back in to make changes, you're missing a bet. I'll talk about that again in a moment. Next chart. All right, now, how is it tracked? Integrated master system.
Okay, I think we jumped one ahead. Yep.
Okay, first thing, you treat any major security system upgrade or system implementation as a project, not an additional duty. You assign a project manager, you have identified resources, and that individual has what I call responsibility, authority, and accountability. If you do not get him or you do not get all three of those, you will not be as effective as you need to be to come up with a system. The individual is held responsible, he is accountable for its success or its failure, and he has the authority to get the help he needs. That's why if the individual is reporting higher up the chain, it's much easier. And so on at least 10 occasions, we did that at the nuke site. We need to make an improvement in something or a modification to something. It was called the Management System Improvement Project, the Electrical Safety Improvement Project. But there was a project manager. He or she had a budget, had a work breakdown structure that said where the money was going to be applied, and they reported the results of their earned value every month to me. What does all it entail? We talked about this. That's important. An individual in charge. Who does it involve? Everybody that's needed. The engineers, the finance guys. You might even need the lawyer because there may be some legal issues involved in the system. How is it planned? It's planned by the project manager and the people who are assigned to the project. Now, we don't have the option, we don't have the luxury of full-time projects in the sense of everybody is 100% of the time on that project. You share resources. The key is to have a project manager and a project, if you will, budget control individual and scheduler. Those two must be there all the time. You need an engineer. You call him in, does what's needed, they go charge someplace else for their time. How is it executed and tracked? Through some sort of earned value system. But in your integrated master schedule, you have a number of people that were supposed to be assigned, what they were supposed to get done, and what it was supposed to cost. Every month you get an update on how that is going. And in certain cases, you can get weekly data so that you can correct a bad trend even faster. Next chart. Now, did you skip one?
Yep.
Okay. I'm not going to go back through that. We've talked about it. the two worker bees, if you will, the PM and the planner scheduler, they do it weekly. And then they bring in senior management monthly. If you say it's every quarter, one, the quarter's over and it takes 4 to 6 weeks to get the report ready. That ain't gonna work. You're working with, so I would be working with data that was useless. So that's why I insisted on timeliness of it. Next chart. Okay, what do you do? What do you measure? You know, I've always been, I'm a reliability kind of warrior. How is the system, how many airplanes can I get off the ground out of a squadron on any particular day? What's its capability rate, as an example? All right, let's say you have some individual there sitting, he's looking at six scopes. If on the average only four of them are working, that's not a good thing. So what's the reliability of the systems? Do you have a system or a component that is beyond its useful life? What's the failure rate? Is it increasing? Is it stable? What's the mean time to repair? Is it taking 1 hour straight, or now all of a sudden I'm seeing 1.5 hours, I'm seeing 2 hours, getting more and more different? You know your system's going to fail. So you got to design reliability into the system. You have to look at how it performs. If it's supposed to detect a threat and respond to it, and some of the times it doesn't detect it, some of the time it gives you false alarm, or it doesn't respond. Any one of those three are bad. False alarms will get you into as much trouble as just about anything else. Some of you may remember there was an incident at a nuclear site in the Department of Energy where an 80-year-old nun managed to get all the way up to the building. One of the reasons for that was system reliability and false alarms. They were getting so many false alarms that some of the guards were just punching them off. Here, these people got all the way up because they had all the alarms, but they had so many false alarms in the history that they ignored them. So human factors fitted in there too, the ability for those people to ignore the situation.
And in fact, even that similar example, but in a healthcare, they actually just turned off all 850 alarms that related to intrusion detection in the hospital. Now, when Joint Commission came in, that came up an issue if you're involved with healthcare. But it was the same way, of false alarms that weren't maintained and operated at set. But when you look at, in that same context of measuring, there's measurement, as my father mentioned, there's measurement at the project when you're deploying the project. And that's deploying of putting that system into place, getting the capability, and then bringing it into the operational context. That's another management of the project and measurements as to how that is progressing. Then there's the operations capability of that equipment, of the actions that are taken by people. And then you've got the next level of metrics, and that metric is the who cares metric. So what if I had all the right systems, all the right people, all the right training, and it didn't help with the mission? It solved the wrong problem for the mission. If my objective was to reduce loss and my loss went up, then I have the great solution for the wrong problem. That's where you're taking it every step in the way and looking at how that is tying in at that overall performance level. And another way to measure at that mission level is looking at the risk. What is my actual risk that I'm seeing based upon the performance? I've got a probability that says I'm going to have a 20% probability of loss per year at a certain level. I have my predicted level of loss based on my systems that are coming online. Did I achieve that with today's actual, which was what did I predict? And that's one thing that is a tough challenge, because now you have to eat your own dog food. If you've done the assessment and said, this is the golden nugget that's going to solve our problem, if you don't come back after it's put in place and reevaluate it to see if you got there, then you don't have a closed loop system. And so there's no one saying, are you really a top performer and did you really contribute to the organization? Or did you totally blow it and you should have been fired 8 years ago? Well, you only got hired 6 years ago, so you should have never been hired in the first place. I'm sure y'all know some of those folks as well.
Let me give you a real life example of you develop the system, you field it, you got that feedback loop. But let me put you into a real life situation where we had a situation where the federal government had made a decision to have a separate contract for armed security and a separate contract for risk assessment. I was responsible for the overall. There was no contractual linkage. No associate contractor agreements. We had no privity of contract. We couldn't tell the other two to do anything. So, okay, what do you have to do? You have to have somebody take the stick, if you will, a control stick, not the beat on them stick, and get people together. What I did was I got with the head of the armed security guys. I got to know him. I got to know the guy that was head of the risk assessment contract. We started out having lunch once a month where it was no particular agenda, but it was, let's just talk about how we're doing with everything. Then I brought in my direct report chief of security, and I said, okay, we need to come up with a system of metrics that measure operational effectiveness and readiness. The armed security guys needed X number of armored vehicles in order to be able to do their job on a site as big as Rhode Island. In order to have that number of vehicles in commission, the guys in my contract maintained the vehicles, so I had the motor pool. That meant there was a certain turnaround time. The security guy can't bring his vehicle in, and we tell him, we'll get it back to you at some point, and finally get it back to him. So we had the armed security guys establish the requirement. Here's how many I need. Here's how many I need as a minimum. Here's the turnaround time. Here's the number of spares I need. They established their requirements. Okay, all of a sudden now, the motor pool guys knew exactly what they needed to be doing and how to track it. Then the three guys, the four people, including the head of security, got together once a month with the head of security for the nuclear site, the Fed, and went over the data. How are we doing? Well, after the fit hit the Shan with the nun getting through the gate and all that good stuff, mass punishment being the substitute for leadership, everybody was evaluated and all of that good stuff, we came out smelling like a rose. Well, they don't have a problem like those other guys did. They are integrated. They're tracking the data. They're responding to the data. So it's not just measuring the data while you're developing and fielding the system. It's measuring a different set of more important data that you know it's operating, and the COO, CEO, whoever can operate in a very unpuckered manner because he knows what's going on. Next chart.
And as you move that through, how do you look at what's moving ahead? Are you making decisions where you've optimized the system today based on today's decision? But if you've got scheduled events, and maybe that scheduled event is that you're moving into into hurricane season, or you're moving into a time where you know the weather's going to be bad or something else, or you've got a merger that's coming up or an acquisition, whether you take it through within, as this description of those elements that are, someone's got to be the forward leader, the forward looker to know that the metrics are what's my performance historically. But understanding those metrics to know which ones are leading indicators and which ones are trailing indicators. Because you want to be postured so you're looking to solve tomorrow's problems today, not having to solve yesterday's problems next week. And that's where that dynamic in time can get lost if you aren't continually looking at, and that comparison of predictive, what do I see going on, the changes in my organization at the same time.
Yeah, and just a quick example, if you've got a premise that the reliability is declining, okay, that's going to influence the number of spares you have. Because if it's less reliable, I need more spares. or it's now reaching the point where the cost per maintenance hour is getting so high, it's time I developed a new element of the system. So those are predictive indicators, not how many people got in. That's a trailing indicator. Next chart. Okay, we've gone through the success, the feedback. Go ahead. Now, back to Bedford providing value, but if you can get a fully integrated system that starts out with a risk assessment and the amount of risk the corporation will accept, you feed that into the development and the operational process, you've managed for success and you maximize the probability of making money. You're not a drag, you're not an administrative overhead cost. You are a fundamental direct support to where the corporation wants to go.
And keeping your eyes open to the fact that live outside of your own world. Make sure you understand your expertise. You're here. You've gone through your professional development to manage how can I be the best security professional. Understand the context you're in and realize the context for your business operation, but also realize the context for who is or what is it that wants to do you harm. Because the value, when we were in the nuclear weapons world, the value of a nuclear bomb to the United States was different than the value of a nuclear weapon to a terrorist group. Before the days of Photoshop, an 8x10 color glossy of a scumbag sitting there touching and holding the container or associated with the container of a nuclear weapon was very powerful. Now, all they want to do is they just want to get in with their GoPro and do a live feed in line that they are there. That publicity value, they don't even need to have the weapon to get a lot of activist and a lot of scare tactics. Look at your assets. Look at the way you perceive those things to look that through in evaluating the risk. That gives the context that you can express back and forth in with your senior management. Then you build your programs based on that. We have just last week looking at a pipeline project. Their biggest issue, if you started from the beginning in the risk, the biggest issue was the activist. And the activist wasn't damaging the pipeline. The activist was wanting to get and build up public distrust for the organization and regulatory bumps, so it slowed down the certification and the licensing for them to be able to build and move forward. So that was the perception, and that's what was sitting in and bothering the CEO more than anything else. So once those were established, the risks were identified, shared up as part of, then a plan was developed with the CEO because they bought in and started working through that whole system of solution, which involved a whole number of issues with monitoring, with event management, information protection, a whole host of things, so that then they could then take and look at their performance. And their performance was, what was the project management for the process? Were they getting their licenses? What were some of their indicators? They were looking at social media. How are they managing social media and viewing, not so much managing it actively, but looking at the feedback to see were the elements that in the program, were they going contrary to the corporation or not? As they saw a better performance for the corporation, they coupled that with more efficient move to actually get their construction underway. And all of that in a manner that was contextual and security could show they were benefiting that organization in a very soft manner. Very different than equipment elements, but it all was in that same context.
So, and if you take away one word from these last 55 minutes, it's integration. You've got to think out of your own box. And that will start you on the path to success. You want to give 5 minutes for questions here? Or?
Yeah. If we open up for thoughts, go ahead. Sure.
The question is, how can we manage threat improvement? Those threats have no end. Let me give you an example. I'm responsible for corporate security. and so on, and how personal the people protection, personal the people reach. So how can we manage?
Okay. Ben, do you want to, or I can take it either.
The issue, if we didn't hear, is really managing risks that are continuous. And in a personnel protection, and in this case happens to be Latin America, which is an environment that certainly has its challenges. That in itself, because it is it's a dynamic, and those threats and the risks do change over time. So it's looking at your system and continually evaluating that risk as part of the feedback loop of performance management. And that feedback loop comes in at this is your daily, weekly operation, and then you take another cycle, unless you have a system that actually pulls it in real time, and which is something that's been our mission, and we've developed a solution to manage that. But you can soft manage it in with continually looking, am I still looking at the same threat? Has it changed? And if I put in countermeasures that didn't impact the risk, but the threat stayed the same, then I've got the wrong countermeasure. Or I didn't get the countermeasure that provided the value that was really going to have the payback. So I hope that...
Think about it, situational awareness. You've got to be aware of how the situation is changing around you, and it's the bad guy or the threat negating something you are doing so that you make a change.
I've struggled with the issue of quantization of this sort of thing for many, many years. And how do you measure the success or failure of a security program, performance measure? You know, when you call a guy in, how do you measure that? I mean, in security, we measure that basically as an absence of loss. But, that could occur in one incident, just blow everything up. But I'm thinking, are you thinking, when you're talking about performance measurement, are you thinking of things like how many people pass the gate or how many, I measure as a security person as the number of incidents I didn't pass. So how can you quantify
that? You've got, again, situation where watching for trends that are occurring. How many real alarms are you getting? How many false alarms are you getting? Attempted intrusions are you getting? The nuclear test site gets on the order of 800,000 hits a weekend.
That's a measurable thing.
We need a measurable thing. So and the only success criteria is they didn't get in. So you've got to watch trends and make adjustments in the stringency of what you are doing to keep your record good. Because if you always look at the trailing indicator, the number of incidents.
That's about the same thing. What you're talking about is almost exactly the same thing. Yeah. It's actually saying how many of those false alarms were real and how much were, in the world that I deal in, they're all false. Thank you, the Lord. They're all false alarms. But, how many burglars did you have? One?
But if you're looking at a couple of things to think through. One is, from a pure operation standpoint, that is, what is the what's my time frame to be able to identify, react, and respond? Is that moving down? So that now if there is something real, I've reduced the impact that it's had on the corporation of that robbery because I was there faster. What's my speed if I'm looking at a gate and I've got penetrations into the gate versus actual operations? What is the speed and the fluidity of moving the right resources into the gate versus the amount that I've had to delay and find out what was forward or not? So, yes, there's the oh my God, I didn't have any break-ins until I put an alarm system. So all of a sudden my metrics say, wow, this new security program really stinks.
And they're all false.
Well, whether they're false or not, but there's an indicator, one, and you have to manage those expectations. If you're introducing something new on that standpoint, measuring what you weren't measuring.
It is new, so those of you need to be asleep too. Yeah. We will be here after meeting you here. Yeah. We are going to go get some groceries. And we'll be here this afternoon. Yeah. So we'll be happy to meet back with me anytime.
Thank you.